Assalamu alaikum. I hope you have done what we have covered in the last lecture. So the last time we introduced this course with something that I did not name it, but the sinusoidal analysis of circuits. Sinusoidal analysis, also called as the AC analysis, of electric circuits or electric networks. We started with this. In fact, the end result of what we are going to study at the start of this course. And I will take some time in trying to develop the rationale behind why we did those steps. Remember in the last lecture, we considered a circuit with a sinusoidal source, and then RLC components in the circuit, and then through some magic we transformed the circuit into an equivalent sort of DC circuit with all the component values in ohms, but the resistors remained real valued and the inductors and capacitors turned into imaginary values. Inductor became a positive imaginary value and capacitors became negative imaginary values. So while a resistor here in this magic world, the transformed domain, is called a resistance, these resistors drawn as resistors are not called resistors but reactances. So this is a resistance. The real valued are resistances. The imaginary valued are reactances. And this is the source. Then we solved using all the concepts we learned in the DC analysis or LCA and came up with the current IS, which is written in capital. It's important here in this time domain. Things are in small because they are dependent on time and variable. Here they are not variable, they are constant. So we wrote this as Vs, we wrote this as Is, then we solved it, and because the solution involved complex numbers, we took some time and solved it. So you see, we came up with the current as a complex number. This complex number, the current, was written as a complex number in polar form, and then starting from here we applied the inverse magic. So here, because of some magic, we came from this to this. Here, because of the inverse magic, we went from this to this expression. How was it written is not difficult. So this thing written here, cos of t plus brought back somehow, and then this thing is written here. And because the original forcing function had a ut here, we brought a ut here. There was no response, and there was no the source was shorted out before t is equal to 0 because of this ut, and this had been in this form for a long time, so there would be no current or voltage in the circuit. This it would be 0 at that time as well. So when this started to act like a cos function, after some time this current will be established in the circuit. And why I am saying after some time? Because you know, in every circuit, at least in every RLC circuit, for example, this one, in any circuit that involves these inductors or capacitors or both, it takes some time before the circuit attains a steady state value. So we went through this knowledge in LCA that if we apply a DC source, like say a 10 volt source at t equal to 0, then a sudden DC current will not start flowing in this circuit. So suppose this is the current we are interested in, and we know the inductor opposes sudden change in current. So before t equal to 0, there was no current flowing through the inductor, and after t equal to 0, the inductor will try to maintain that. But since we have a forcing function, this will slowly force the circuit to attain a steady state current because of this inductor. So while the forcing function is a sudden application of voltage, this is what 10 UT looks like. If we draw the resulting current in the circuit in a similar fashion, we are not going to get a DC current. What happens? The current starts from zero, attains some final value after some time. And how much time is this? How much time is this? If you remember, we discussed that this is roughly 5 time constants. In these 5 time constants, the current will increase from here to here. So this part is the steady state part, and this part, the 5 time constants part, is the transient state. To understand how this part will look like, we need to analyze a circuit in this transient state. But often this 5 time constants is not much of a time, so sometimes we ignore this state and say all we are interested in is the steady state. So when we need to analyze a circuit in the steady state only, so and the forcing function is an AC source, AC function, or a sinusoidal function, we say we are dealing with a sinusoidal steady state circuit, or the analysis would be known as the sinusoidal steady state analysis. So in future, if you come across these 3 S, it would mean the sinusoidal steady state analysis. Here we are going to come across sources or forcing functions, VTs, which are something like this. So we may have a Vm max value, a sinusoidal function, some number here, and T, and then some number here, say theta. And ut is implied, we are not interested in something that happened before when we got interested in the circuit. So if we have the same RL circuit, now this current IT is what we want to find by solving such a circuit. So with a sinusoidal forcing function, and similarly, so if you try to plot this one and imagine for a moment that this theta is 0 degrees and say this omega is 1, and we will soon come to know that this omega represents the radian frequency, so 1 radian per second, and suppose this Vm is also 1 volt. So that we go back to the basic circuit, that Vt is cos t ut. If we now plot this, we are going to get something like this. So it is 0 before t is equal to 0, and then suddenly this voltage starts behaving like a sine function, sinusoidal function, starting as a cosine. A cosine is a sinusoidal function as well. And I hope you remember that cosines and sines can be written interchangeably. So a sine function, sine of x, may be written as a cosine function. Okay, we will come back to that later. However, how will the current look like here? Just like before, the inductor obviously carries the same property here. It will oppose a sudden change in current. So it was 0 before, it will remain 0 after, just after switching, although there is no switching here, but this ut implies switching. So it will not suddenly become a sinusoid of some sort. Instead, it will take some time. And when we will analyze this, we will come to know that this circuit may look something like this. So it does not start as a good cosine. Instead, it is starting from a different point in the cosine function. So while this may be cos t, this it may be something like, say, so here we have a 1, this may be something less than 1, so let me write it as capital Im for the maximum value of current. This is the maximum value of voltage, which in this case is 1. Im cos of t, and we are going to get something here, plus phi, say. This phi is the amount this waveform is shifted. This phi is positive if this is shifted this way, and negative if this is shifted this way. Or did I say the reverse? It is negative shifted this way. Why? Because this is the time axis, and anything happening later in time is a delay. So a delay is represented by a negative sign. So can you see that this voltage started from here? Although it repeats itself, after a cycle, complete cycle. However, we can see that this waveform got delayed by this amount. Can you see that? This much part is the amount by which this waveform got delayed. So this started here, this actually started here. So this delay is what this phi is. And in this example, this phi would be negative, because that signifies delay. And remember, a delay matches this thing, the nature of an inductor. An inductor opposes sudden change in current. So we applied a sinusoidal forcing function here. The current had a delayed response. However, it will not look like this. What I want to signify is that the current may begin with something zero, and it will take some time to grow up to a value that will ultimately flow. So what's happening? So it did not start right away like a nice sinusoid. It slowly increased in value until it attained the required value. So what's